Guardians. What is going on, guys? Welcome back to another Midsummer event in Destiny 2. Solstice of Heroes has officially kicked off just a few short hours ago, and with more and more stuff piling on top, different kinds of quests, DLCs, updates, I thought I'd make a quick video showing off how to start Bungie's summer event, how to acquire your first set of armor, upgrade it, and also how the new game mode is going to work. So with that, guys, let's dive in and check it out. As always, your journey starts off at the tower. Head on over to Ellen DeGeneres at Eververse and grab your bounty for some easy free loot, and then go see Evil Levante, who has been awesomely placed right next to the statue this year. So right off the bat, you earn your green helmet for the parade armor. Now, since cross-save is coming, I've jumped back onto Xbox so I can get all of my main characters up to speed. I've been playing on PC for quite a few months now, so that's the reason why I'm below 700 or at 700 on some of these characters. My console crew is definitely a little behind. I totally wish Bungie would implement some kind of merging feature, but I guess that's how it is. Anyways, first thing you want to do, guys, is hover over your helmet and take a look. Just like last year's event, the armor has requirements that you need to fulfill in order to upgrade to the next quality or the next step. You start off with the drained green set, which upgrades to the blue renewed, and finally finishes off as a majestic set, which can then be masterworked if you want to go the whole nine yards. The helmet is rather easy to get. You get it in the first few minutes of the event. But for the rest of the armor, that requires you to follow Evil Levante's instruction and then dive into the new gameplay mode called a European Aerial Zone, or EAZ for short. This new aerial zone is a three-person matchmaking enabled mode that is pretty similar to the Verdant Forest or Spooky Forest of past events. However, even though it's similar, it is definitely not the same. The hologram of the floating island on the right-hand side of the statue is your ticket to this new zone. Or if you're in the director, you can just look at the tower and you'll see it just like the Spooky Forest was back in the day. It's that blue thing right at the very top. Now, I was kind of hoping it could be accessed in free play or patrol, or you could see people doing it, like, you know, while you're out on patrol, but it doesn't look like that's going to be happening. It seems like it's its own separate area away from everything else. Anyways, activate the aerial zone and then dive on in. Now, this area is actually fairly big, and most of the buildings you see while you're here actually have rooms inside them, as well as tunnels that lead through it. There's also a lot of shortcuts, teleporters, cracks in the walls, scalable ruins, etc. So this place has a lot of square footage available to run through. It's not just big buildings taking up space that you really can't get into. So in terms of available area, this place is actually pretty big. Now, how it works is like this, guys. Every day there will be a rotating daily element. For today, the very first day of this event, it's solar. Now, unlike last year, this year each element has a different property to it. Once you collect enough elemental orbs, you will see the number on the bottom left of your screen, and once you hit 30, you will become empowered, and that's when that daily element comes out to shine. For example, solar empowerment gives you a pulsating ring which damages enemies nearby. While empowered with arc elemental power, guardians move with enhanced speed and deal grade A melee and sword damage. And as for the void elemental power, crouch while empowered to become invisible, just like a hunter, and gain true sight plus enhanced ability regeneration. So you basically get a piece of the hunter super when you have your void. Now that can be taken on any subclass and any character, so I think that's pretty cool how they kind of have it swapped here. So because of the way each element behaves, it's good to pay attention on which day you're playing. The flame in front of the statue at the tower will indicate what day you're on, and it will also be listed on your character screen as well. You'll also see it when you launch up to orbit. Now, for the aerial zone itself, you start out with a task to kill as many mini-bosses as you can within a certain time limit. Now, this number is relatively important, as I'll explain here in a few, but even if you only down one or maybe even two, you cannot fail this event. You just won't get that much in terms of loot. So after you chased around and killed mini bosses, keep trying to kill as many as possible. You will see groups of adds pretty much everywhere, but do not let them distract you. You want to go for mini bosses only. Now sometimes you'll see something called a blighted taken that spawns during the event, but as of right now, not 100% sure what that means, as the event is only a few hours old. So stay tuned for an update when I figure out what that's all about. So after you killed all your mini bosses, next you're going to head into a boss battle. Kill your bosses or boss and then collect the chest that spawns as your reward. What you want to do is wait till everyone gets to that chest before you open it, because as soon as you do, secret hidden chests will instantly appear all around the map, and the number is dependent on how many mini bosses your team killed during that first round. So the more mini bosses you take down, the more secret chests can spawn at the end. You have a limited amount of time to collect them. And even though you see icons at first, they disappear rather quickly and only reappear once you get close to a chest. The best thing is to have your teammates kind of looking outwards from your main reward chest. Think of it kind of like back to back to back. Try to memorize your closest chest and head that way. Some of these chests are pretty far. Even though they might look close, it's kind of deceiving. And remember, this area has a lot of square footage in terms of places you can go, so you want to try to get there as quickly as possible. Every chest opened will give the entire team key fragments. Once the after activity timer expires, head back up into orbit and then go check out the tower. You can go ahead and turn in your bounty you completed for Eververse and get a free engram, and also check out Ava Levante, you get some cool loot. After a little bit of dialogue, you're going to meditate at the middle statue, and the rest of your drained green armor set will appear, as will Ava's bounties. Now, as far as key fragments go, they're pretty much just that, guys. Fragments of a key that, when combined with 15 total, you can unlock Solstice treasure boxes. These boxes are given to you by completing certain bounties and from the boss reward chest in the aerial zone. So far, that's the only places I've found, but there could be more. They are mainly a source for enhancement cores, as the loot is not really powerful, and it's kind of the same stuff that drops from legendary engrams. However, I do think there are chances to get cool stuff like glow packages, but they are rare if it's similar to last year. The full loot pool is still currently being looked at, so keep an eye out for that, as I'll try to update you guys when I know everything that can drop from them. Now, as you complete multiple runs of the EAZ, you start upgrading your armor slowly but surely, and notice that each piece can hold what's known as a glow packet. Now, this is essentially an ornament that adds a bit of flair and changes color depending on what packets you use. If you look inside Eververse, the full packets are for sale and rather expensive. The cool thing is you don't have to wait for a majestic armor set to use these glow packages. You can use them from the drain set all the way up to a masterwork set. Now, one cool thing Bungie is doing is that if you manage to upgrade your armor to the highest quality available, which, like I said, is the majestic quality, before the end of the event, Banshee will have a legendary version of that armor set waiting for you when Shadowkeep drops. And the good thing is, it'll be the new Armor 2.0 variant. So that's a bonus, definitely worth shooting for. Just for a quick knowledge drop, if you completed the armor set from last week's Iron Banner, that too will also be available as an armor set in Shadowkeep as Armor 2.0. Also, the next week, Lord of Wolves Emblem and Triumph will be handed out, but as a surprise, if you were there for Laser Tag Weekend, in which Prometheus Lens was straight up broken for that week, another cool emblem commemorating that week of fun will also be handed out to those who played at least one Crucible match during that time. But for now, that's pretty much it, Guardians. I just wanted to make a quick video giving out a rough explanation of how the event works in general, what you need to do to get started. And I'll have another video coming out soon talking about the spawn and take an enemy, as well as a few other hidden things within the event. So stay tuned for that. But for now, I am out of here, guys. As always, thank you for watching and for supporting Sly Nation. If you're new to the channel, then welcome, my friend. Subscribe for lots more Destiny 2, Cyberpunk, Anthem, and Fallen Order videos. Spank the thumbs up, but only if you enjoyed yourself. And if you want to catch up on social media, feel free to check me out over on Twitter at Sly Nation or Facebook at Sly Nation Gaming. Keep those eyes open for more videos coming out here soon. But until then, this is your dude Sly, and I'll catch you guys next time.